At the disbelief of many, the remnant boot camp is now over. We're going to enter into some other things, and I've actually got a lot of scripture that I want to go over this morning. And so instead of us doing Bible drills from one end of the Word of God to the other, I thought I'd make PowerPoint slides. We had to make them for the video anyway. And that way, instead of trying to rush and keep up with me, because we've got a lot of stuff that I want to cover this morning, we can just simply look at the screen and keep up with where I'm going. God has been dealing with me a lot regarding the power of remembering. The word remember appears in the English Bible 148 times in 144 verses. Do you think God is trying to get us to remember some things? Man is called to remember, and when you see it in the Word of God, there are, when either God remembers or man remembers, his people remember, it's pivotal times in the history of Israel that God uses that remembering to change things. And what I have found is that one of the tactics of the enemy is that he causes you to forget. How many have ever had God really show something that was revolutionary, that was real revelation in your life, and a year later you forgot the very thing that God showed you that gave you a piece to the puzzle? That is not human nature, that is the work of the enemy. Now I want to take a look here at 2 Corinthians, and this is talking about how the devil blinds the minds of those in the world from hearing the gospel. And it says, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine upon them. Now, one of the things that we need to realize is, although our God is unlimited, how many are glad about that? He is unlimited. There is not an end to his power. There is not an end to his wisdom. There is not an end to his glory. There is not an end to his power or his dominion. But Satan is limited. He only has a relatively small bag of tricks. And if he blinds the minds of those that would hear the gospel, he also actively blinds the minds of the saints so they can't walk in who they are in Christ. In fact, I call this the Babylonian haze. When we were dealing in aspects of spiritual warfare years ago, we discovered that the occult, especially if they're thriving within a community, can haze out that community using spiritual forces so that people never really catch on. People that should be connecting the dots seem to be in a trance-like state that never really connect the dots. And the more that we learn, the more we discover, we find out that is more than just that haze there, that he begins doing things to cause us to forget. And here's how he does it, guys. Well, I don't want to get ahead of myself. I've got so much I'm wanting to share, I'm already racing ahead in my mind. But let's go ahead and let's look at the tactics of the enemy. The first one is found in Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. He said, there, brethren, I do not count myself as having apprehended this, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I mean, that's what we're all called to. There are things that we got to forget so that we can remember. I'm finding out that we're just like computers, that there's only so much bandwidth in us, that there's only so much that we can have in our consciousness. You can't focus on two separate things at the same time. Man is not able to multitask. And if we fill our minds with one thing, we displace the other. That's a principle that's all throughout the world of God of spiritual displacement. When Israel was in Egypt, Satan displaced them by filling it full of Canaanites that were Nephilim and were occultists and that were pagans. And that when God called Israel to come back and to take the land, they had to drive out the inhabitants, didn't they? They had to displace it. And so even within physical land, there's only so much bandwidth. The word forgetting here in the Greek is epilanthanomai. Long word. And this word forgetting means to forget, neglecting, no longer cared for, forgotten, given over to oblivion. Forgetting those things that are past. Well, how do you forget those things that are past? You forget them, you neglect them. You no longer give power, you no longer give bandwidth within your mind. You no longer think of those things, you neglect them until they are given over to oblivion. We need to understand that so many times in our lives, we need to forget who we were before Christ so that we can begin remembering and discovering who we are in Christ. You ought to be getting happy right now. Satan reverses this in our lives. He causes us to forget who we have become to remember who we were. Let me say that again. He causes us to forget who we have become and to remember who we were, because the moment that you forget who you are now in Christ, you go back to old habits, you go back to old ways, you go back to old mindsets, you go back to who you were, who is supposed to be dead in Christ. Now here's the interesting thing. We forget or remember many times by what we do, to include our speech as much as what we think. Let's go back to the very definition of forgetting again. To forget, to no longer care for. And that doesn't mean just care for and desire. That means you no longer tend to it. The more you think about something, the more that you do something, the more that you speak something, you are tending to it, you are nurturing it within your being. And as long as you dwell on the past of who you were, as long as you think about all your mistakes and all these different things, you are tending to it, you are causing it to grow and be more manifest in your life. We have got to stop that, and we have got to start tending to who we are in Christ, because that is the greater reality. If the old man is dead, let it die. If you have put off the old man, don't pick it back up. I've got to put on who I am in Christ Jesus and begin no longer neglecting that, but maintaining that and enforcing that. Let's look here in James chapter 1. But be a doer of the word and not a hearer only. How many Christians today, they go week after week after week, and they hear and they hear and they hear, but now we have a theology of not doing. When you take away the commandments of God, you have nothing to enforce who you now are. Because the commandments have two purposes. Before I was saved, they show me my sinfulness. But now that I am saved, they show me who I have become by the sacrifice that Almighty God gave for me. Let's look at it here. It says, if any be a hearer of the word, not a doer, he is likened unto a man that beholding his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth. You open up the word, I'm more than an overcomer in Christ. That's right. Hallelujah. Boy, I've got a lot of problems. I don't know how I'm going to get over them. That's a tactic of the enemy to forget. Look at verse 25. But whosoever looketh into the perfect Torah, the law of liberty, the Torah of liberty, the Torah now that I'm in Christ shows me how the righteous conduct themselves, and I become a doer of what God says. I begin enforcing the reality, the greater reality of who I am now. But whosoever looketh in the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein. Continueth therein means to maintain it, to reinforce it, to nurture it, to tend to it. Is blessed in his deed. You need to underline that in your Bible if you got your Bibles open. You want to be blessed? You find out who you are in the Torah of liberty and you start doing it. And as you meditate it and tend to it, you're going to be blessed. While Christians run after blessings, like there's some rare thing, and they'll throw money at it and everything else, All God says to do is if you find out who you are and you start doing it, you're going to be blessed. I've got an article I'm getting ready to write on that. We need to quit running after blessing. We're supposed to produce blessing because we are tending to who we are now. We start remembering who we are. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, his religion is in vain. He has not changed subjects here, because doing as much as there are several ways that we do things. We do it with our mouth, we do it with our hands, and we do it with our feet. Come on. And we're going to have to start speaking what the word says. Instead of how bad things are, we need to start bragging about how great God is and how he's going to get us through it. But pure religion undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. And all that's Torah based. All that's encoded into the Torah. Why? Because Torah is a thing. Once you get saved, Torah is a book of doing the kingdom of God. So to forget or to remember can include what I think and meditate upon, and it can be either new thinking based upon the word or the old ruts or the defeat of the past. Your choice. What we say, which is either filled with faith or filled with the flesh and doubt, and by what we do living in the new man, are trying to go back and live in the old corpse that is supposed to be dead in Christ. A lot of us are facing things. Can I tell you where a lot of this is stemming from? At least my teaching of this. That in my own family, we have been going through some things. And I mean, it's been kind of rough. At the same time, God's been blessing, but there's been some rough things. And so we said, God, what's going on here? And he said, you've got so busy in the battle, you forgot who you were. The moment we stopped and began to speak what God said about us, all the faith and all the anointing rushed back. And Mary's here to test that. I mean, the moment, not having to work up to it, not having to try to work something up, the moment that we remembered, whoa, it was right there. But if you forget who you are and you start remembering what you are, there is an anointing of the enemy to bring that back into your life. Let me tell you something. Where we are right now, you're the gatekeeper in your own life. You can either allow the power of God or the power of the devil, but you're the one that chooses. What you choose to speak and to do and to think about is releasing one kingdom or the other. And God is calling us to remember. Our nature is to go toward what we are concentrating on. Forgetting and remembering can affect where we're headed. If we're constantly focused on who we used to be and the mistakes that we made and how the devil got the better of us in times past, no matter what it is, you will, because of your very nature, what you're looking at, you'll always head toward. That's why God says, look at me, look at my kingdom, look at my word, and do not turn to the right hand or to the left. Focus on who you are in Christ. Now I want to look at some things here about remember the power of it. God remembered Noah and the animals on the ark. Amazing. This is one of the first times in the Bible that God remembered. And God remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. And God made a wind to blow on the earth and the waters aswagged. The fountains also of the deep and of the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained, and the waters returned from off the earth continually. And after the end of 150 days, the waters were abated. So here you have the wrath of God being poured out on the earth in this flood that wiped out the Nephilim, that wiped out all the different things that was going on in Genesis chapter 6. And it stayed, it maintained until God remembered. So you see, this principle works with God too. That's why it's over and over again. God remembered. Let's look at another one in Genesis chapter 19, 29. And it came to pass when God destroyed the cities of the plain that God remembered Abraham and sent Lot out of its midst of the overthrow when he overthrew the cities in which Lot dwelt. Because God remembered Abraham and remembered the discussion that he had with Abraham and basically the bartering that Abraham did with God. Before he could destroy, he remembered and rescued Lot out with a high and mighty hand. How many know Lot was glad that God remembered Abram or Abraham? Let's look at another one. The book of Genesis says it this way, or the book of Exodus. And it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up before the Lord by the reason of the bondage. And God heard their groanings, and he remembered. He remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. The moment that God remembered, Moses was conceived. There needs to be some conception going on in the spirit for your miracle. And what you need to do is begin to lift up the word before God and who he is and what he has done in your life. And the moment that you bring it into remembrance to God, something is conceived in the spirit that is going to grow up and eventually be your deliverance in your life. We want everything instantaneous, but you need to realize that you didn't get where you are instantaneously. It started as a seed the devil planted in your life, and it grew to matured until it was like another Pharaoh that rose up that took you bondage. And we have to give, a lot of times we got to give time, God time to seed and to conceive and to mature something, because it takes a mature deliverer to come against a mature oppressor. I'm already happy, and I'm not even halfway through with my sermon yet this morning. God remembered. I think it's time for us to start lifting up the word of God in remembrance before our Heavenly Father. Because it's not like God is forgetful. It's that when they be found, because how long did they ease into bondage and they didn't cry out to God? How many years was it? They were in Egypt for 400 years. And it's like the setting of the sun, and at dusk it just gets darker and darker and darker and darker and darker. How long did they sit in that bondage before they begin to cry out? When they begin to cry out, it prompted God to move because he remembered. And right now in America and many other places of the world, it keeps on getting darker and darker and darker and darker, and we just tolerate it and tolerate it and tolerate it and tolerate it. We forget who we were as a people. The moment that we remember and we begin crying out to God, God can begin to move. Our silence results in silence from heaven. But when we begin to cry out, God remembers. Did you know that David asked God to both remember things and to forget some stuff? I find this fascinating. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let mine enemies have triumph over me. Now, we're saying that, but we don't go with the rest of this. Yea, let none that wait upon thee be ashamed. Let them be ashamed which transgress without cause. Show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy paths, and lead me in the truth, and teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation. On thee will I wait all day. Remember, O Lord, thy tender mercies and thy loving kindness, for they have been ever of old. Remember not the sins of my youth. Lord, forget. Remember your tender mercies, but forget all the stupid stuff I did before I grew up. Forget all the stupid stuff I was involved with before I found Jesus. Forget all the stupid stuff I did when I forget who I even am in Christ. Please forget it, and please remember your tender mercies. Remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to thy mercy, remember thou me for thy goodness' sake, O Lord. So it is actually proper to ask God, please forget all the stupid stuff I've done and bring it under the blood of Jesus. And while you're forgetting, help me forget. Because that man's dead. That man died in Christ. Those things are now under. I was supposed to leave those things under when I was baptized in my own consciousness. That's old, dead, and washed away. And now I have newness of life in Christ. I'm not going to go and pull that dead corpse out of the grave and say that's me anymore, because now I am risen with Christ. How many know that we're seeing speedily the book of Revelation is starting to unfold before us? Now here's one that I love in Revelation 18. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out from among her, my people, for that ye be not, that ye do be not partakers of her sin, and that ye receive not her plagues, for her sins have reached heaven, and God hath remembered. Prophecy hits the fan for Babylon when God remembers her iniquities. Come on, God, remember. And I think part of it is God's people have enough and begin crying out at the weight of Babylon upon them, just like they cried out for the weight of the Pharaoh that was on them. It's the same spirit. It comes from the same family of Ham on the ark. And I get into this in the book I'm just about finished with. But it's the same bloodline. It's the same lineage that comes out. Do you guys realize that not only was mankind saved on the ark, but the very seeds of Babylon resided on the ark? It's amazing. But God has a plan. He says, one of these days I'm going to completely take care of that. It's not going to be around anymore. Now let's look at the power of our remembering. God tells the children of Israel to remember the Passover. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, sanctify unto me all the firstborn. Whatsoever openeth the womb among the children of Israel, both man and beast, it is mine. And Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which ye came out from Egypt, out of the house of bondage, for by strength of the hand of God, of the Lord, brought you out from this place. There shall be no leavened bread shall be eaten. And so he said, every year during Passover, they get all the yeast out, they get all these things out, which is a type and shadow for us to make sure that we examine to get all the yeast of Egypt and Babylon out of our lives. If you don't do it right, you can scour your house and make sure there's not any yeast in your house and your heart be full when you go through the Feast of Unleavened Bread. But he said, every year I want you to remember the bondage and how I delivered you. And there is a direct connection with Passover as there is with communion. This is Paul relating communion that the Lord gave him and said, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body. This is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, a lot of churches will have the communion table, and across the bottom of the communion table, under the top lip, it'll say, in remembrance of me. That's because Passover in the Old Testament is a type and shadow of communion and the finished work of Christ in the New Testament. And every time we take communion, we are remembering how we used to be in bondage, how we used to be a slave to sin. And Messiah came and he gave his broken body and his shed blood to redeem us. And by remembering that I have been delivered, I can move into who I am. You guys need to start doing some remembering this morning. And can I say something? That this may bend your thinking just a little bit. Whenever you learn something new from the Word of God, your soul is learning it, but never your spirit. The minute that you were born again, you were created in Christ Jesus, and your spirit is perfect. And the conflict that we have, and sometimes we read it in the book of Galatians, sometimes we confuse the struggle between the Holy Spirit and our flesh with our own redeemed human spirit and our flesh. That the whole time your spirit knows that this is truth, but your soul hasn't caught up with it. And so when you begin to read it and you hear the truth, something begins to stir in your spirit. It's your spirit saying, I've been trying to get you in line with the Holy Spirit. Your spirit knows and saying, if you could just get it through your head, you'd be set free. And the Holy Spirit tunes in there and says, yeah, I've been working on your soul for a long time. So while your soul is learning, your spirit is remembering. And where you have victory is when the Holy Spirit, your spirit, and your soul all come into agreement. Oh. This stuff's powerful, isn't it? If you get a hold of it. Because 90% of your spiritual warfare is what's between your ears and what you allow to remember and what you allow to forget. And so many times we go back to the old things because Satan gets us to forget who we now are. Why go back to some old dead tomb with a rotting corpse in it when we're supposed to be alive in Christ Jesus? Now here's another one the Bible tells us to remember that we constantly forget. Remember the Sabbath. Now around here we do remember the Sabbath. We've not tried to change it into something else. Remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but on the seventh day is the Sabbath unto the Lord. On the seventh day, on the seventh day, on the seventh day, not on whatever day you want it to be. Almighty God says it's on the seventh day. Sunday the first day, so that makes Saturday the seventh day. You got to learn how to count. But on the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor the stranger that is in thy gates. For 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Now, one of the things that's very easy to point out in the Ten Commandments, in the Decalogue, the longest and most elaborate of all the commandments is the Sabbath. And why did God say remember the Sabbath? Because we're so apt to forget it or to replace it with something else. When you remember the Sabbath, it activates something on the inside of you for supernatural divine rest. We also need to remember God's works. This is a psalm that is chronicled in 1 Chronicles that David wrote. Then on the day David delivered first this psalm to thank the Lord into the hands of Asaph, or Asaphath and his brethren, giving thanks unto the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him, sing psalms unto him. Talk ye of his wonderful works. We need to start talking about the answer and solutions and not the problem. Glory ye in his holy name. Let the heart of them rejoice and seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his marvelous works which he hath done, his wonders and the judgment of his mouth. Remember. One of the things that Mary and I began to do this week, we started remembering, this is what God did. God did this. God did this. God delivered us from this. When they tried to kill us, God did this. When it seemed like that all hope was lost, God did this and turned the whole thing around in a moment's notice. And God is still the same person that he has always been. I am still in reality the same person that can be delivered because of the work of Christ. What I have done is I have forgotten his works. And when I have forgotten his works, my faith goes down. Because what I start remembering is what the devil's doing. And the command of God is forget that and start remembering this. Have you ever had God do something for you that was powerful? How many know getting saved is a powerful thing? The day that God got you to surrender to him and washed your sins away. And that he saved you from yourself and your own sin. He saved you from the devil. He saved you from the kingdom of darkness. That's a powerful, powerful, powerful thing. In fact, every other miracle is downhill from there because that is a supernatural new birth. That is a transformation of supernatural power that is unequaled in the universe. You actually change kingdoms. You change citizenship. You went from under Pharaoh and being a slave to being a son, daughter of God. When I remember that, my faith raises up and saying, what's this situation compared to the God that I serve? What is this situation compared to what he's already done in my life? God has done this and he's done that and he's done that. What's this situation? God's done it before. He can do it again because God has never changed. What must change to a greater reality is this world around me has got to come in line with who I am in Christ and what he has done for me. And the lie has got to die. Because there's one of two things. Either what you were delivered from, the truth is of what you were delivered from? It was a lie. Let me say that again. What you were delivered from was a lie. It was never meant to be you. Along the line, the world placed a lie in your spirit and said you were created to be a slave and to be under bondage and to walk in hopelessness. And God said, that's a lie. Jesus said, I come to bring you truth. Another word for truth in the Greek is reality. I've come to bring you reality. You're living in an unreality. You're living in deception. You're living a lie. I've come to bring you truth, and the truth is I set you free. I died on a cross for you 2,000 years ago, and once you receive that, you cast down the lie, and you begin accepting the truth. And for us, it's remembering. We're remembering what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. That was such a powerful thing, guys. How powerful. The cross is the ultimate singularity in time-space. What that means is when eternity, the blood of eternity began to run down that cross, it was separated outside of our time-space continuum, and it set itself in eternity so that everyone before the cross that hoped in it, when they died, they went into Sheol, but they didn't go into hell. They went into the bosom of Abraham. It is so powerful, it affected them there. And when Jesus came, the Bible says that he went down and he triumphed in it. And then he preached deliverance to those that were in prison. When you take apart the original Greek, the first thing he did is he went through hell. Jesus did not die spiritually, and he did not suffer in hell. The devil, for the first time in his life, found out what hell was when Jesus entered into that place, because he went down and went, ha-ha, I've won! And he triumphed and paraded through hell. And when he got to the end of the corridor, he grabbed the devil up by the throat and said, give me the keys! I just won! And I bet about that time, everybody in Abraham's bosom is kind of trying to look over that cavern to see what is going on. And Jesus comes across it holding the keys. He says, boys, let me tell you what I just did. And it was so powerful that when he resurrected, he took all of them that had hoped in him before he died on the cross. He took them with him. To this day, Abraham's bosom is empty. Now the Apostle Paul says to be absent from the body is to be with the Lord. He's no longer in a waiting room. Oh, I'm getting happy. Some of the stuff that's being preached is no more in the Word than anything. My Jesus didn't go to hell to suffer. He suffered on the cross, and before he finished, he said, it's done. It is finished. I got her done, as they'd say in the Ozarks. And he went down, when he gave up the ghost, he went down to hell to just show the devil just how much he is done with it. And when he rose from the dead, hell, death, and see, we forget that Hades is not just a place of torment. It's the name of a fallen spirit. That Hades, death is a spirit, and the grave is a spirit, and they couldn't keep him down. They just backed up and said, pardon me, I'm going to let you come on through. Because they know one day he's going to say, I've had about enough of you. I'm going to take you. How many know hell itself, both the spirit and the physical place, one day is going to be cast into the lake of fire? He says, let me show you how much I'm done with you. I'm going to throw you in Gehenna. I'm going to throw you into the place that we just burn the garbage. Oh, that's how great our God is. I just finished chapter 9 of my book, and it was so much fun. Because I get to the Valley of Armageddon. Here Nimrod has gathered all his transgenic super soldier army to stand to wipe out Israel and to try to storm heaven itself. If we could even get a glimpse of it, we have Steven Spielberg, George Lucas do not have big enough minds to wrap themselves around the Valley of Armageddon. Because not only do we have all this absolutely corrupted flesh, like in Genesis 6, marching to do all this stuff, we have the watchers that have been bound since Genesis 6 are loose. We have every principality and power. We could even throw UFOs into that thing to give them air support. And this is the mother of all wars. This is every demon, every fallen angel, everything the earth can muster is marching toward this confrontation with God. And when this portal opens, they think they're going to storm heaven, and instead there's one comes out on a white horse, and then all it takes is him to speak a word, and instantly they're decimated. And this transgenic corruption, its blood flows the 200 miles of that valley, at least 2.5 to 4.5 foot tall high through that valley. The greatest of all wars, Satan mustered all that he could do, and it's a 30-second war. And then God had me write these words. When Jesus came back and went into that valley, what he was simply doing was taking out the trash. He grabs up the Antichrist. He grabs up the false prophet. He casts them alive into the lake of fire. He grabs up the elite who have made themselves demigods to where they can't even die. And so guess what? They get thrown alive into the lake of fire. And Jesus comes and says, I'm taking out the trash. We got a new administration. That's all it is. Is him taking out the trash. That's how great our God is. Satan's ultimate war. In that valley, one third of the angels that fell with him are there to fight with him. All of that 30-second war. Oh, this war could last for years. This war is going to be the greatest thing that heaven and earth has ever seen. Jesus pokes his head out of that portal and says, poop, be gone. That's the end of the war. 5,000 years they have worked on this. And all it takes is him speaking a word. They forgot. Well, Nimrod has had unfinished business or unfinished work. Jesus came back because he has some unfinished business. He's coming back as Messiah ben David. That's the God that we serve, the coming, conquering king. If he can decimate everything the devil can muster that he has worked 5,000 years on with just one word, all he needs to do is get you in line with his word to bring you out of what you're in right now. Come on. Remember. Revelation. And this is Jesus' correction to the church. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou hast left thy first love. They forgot. They forgot. They forgot what the first love was. They forgot who they had become. They went back to other things. Remember, therefore, from whence thou hast fallen, and repent and do the first works. Start doing the word again. Go back and do what you're supposed to be doing instead of all the junk that you begin remembering of who you were. Forget that and start remembering the right stuff. Lest thou will come unto thee quickly and remove the candlestick from out of his place, except thou repent. You know that has happened in churches? because the candlestick is not only can be an angel, it can also be translated minister, because that's what an angel is, but also the minister in a place, the one that has really been set by God, is a candlestick under the direct authority of Jesus. And we have a lot of churches that have written across the top of it that the glory has departed because Almighty God reached down and took that man of God and says, you don't need to sit with that mess anymore. I'm going to put you somewhere I can use you. And they can go ahead and have all the hirelings they want in that place. And they can even build super mega churches around a hireling. And God is not in it because they wouldn't go back and repent and remember what God had done. They created their own religion that their flesh could be palatable to their flesh. And God is not in it. He's removed the candlestick. God also calls us to remember sound doctrine, Revelation 3:1-2. And unto the angel of the church at Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, and I know thy works, and that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things that remain and that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before the Lord. Remember, 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 remember therefore what thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. There's a lot of repenting needs to go on in the church today because we are so apt to run after every wind of doctrine that we think can build a bigger church or build a bigger ministry or bring in more money. We will run after it with this as fast as we can. And to do that, you have to abandon what the true word of God has said to run after something new. And Jesus is saying, you know what? Mr. Preacher of Perversion, you're causing my people to forget. You used to have an aim. You used to preach the truth. But now that name is that you're dead as far as heaven is concerned. Now you go back and you start remembering the basic foundational principles of the Word of God and return to sound doctrine, repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come as a thief in the night. For thou knowest not what hour I will come upon it. Jesus comes as a thief in the night to the church that's off, that has forgotten, that has filled itself full of error. For the saints, for the remnant, he does not come as a thief in the night because they're alert and in line with him and are ready for his coming. That's a part of what this remembering. If I'm going to be ready for his coming, and I don't care what eschatological position you take, if Jesus is coming pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, just whatever you do, do not be all millennial. We are not in the millennium now, millennial reign now. If we are, I want a refund. But the key to being ready, no matter when the harpazo comes, that catching away comes, you got to be ready and you got to be looking up and you got to have your garments without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Jesus is not coming back for a bride that has half her teeth missing, has never seen a beauty parlor in forever, and that has tattered, stained with sin clothes. He's coming back for a victorious bride that has no spot or wrinkle or any such thing. She's walking in true biblical holiness and she's walking in biblical victory because she has forgotten the right things and she has remembered the right things. Now what I want to pray as we close today, I want a supernatural ability of God to help you forget the things that you need to forget. Forgetting the farmer things. I heard one preacher say years ago, the quickest way to get the devil to shut up about who you used to be is start reminding him where he's headed. We need to quit giving our mental bandwidth and our spiritual and mental energies to what is supposed to be dead in Christ and start focusing on who we are now in him and how to function within the kingdom. And so, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, I just loose an anointing of the kingdom of God and of your spirit into this place. And, Father, I call for a supernatural anointing of your spirit to help us forget the things of the past, the sinfulness of the past, who we used to be when we were in bondage. Father, let us forget it. Let it only be a part of our testimony of what we have been delivered from, and that who that was is now dead in Christ. And Father, we ask that you would help us to begin to remember, and that we will become an active participant in remembering what you have done and what you have said and who you have made us, because that is the greater reality. And Father, let us walk in your reality from this day forth, in Jesus' name.